Well, I gave everyone a little rest during Christmas, and I figured, well, okay, let's not push things too much. Most people have some obligations at Christmas. That's fine. Now it's the day after Christmas. Now it's time to shift into high gear, which I certainly have already done. I woke up at 4 o'clock in the morning, day after Christmas, and spent hours and hours and hours going through very, very intense inner contemplation. I don't know if I can even express it. Actually, the wow, the shock of the wow is very strong. But what I do know is that we are now, I would say, in a 5-month period through May, where we need to go all out and then put the icing on the cake in June. July, something is going to happen in July of 2016 in some way. But we want to be fully confirmed in our clarity. Absolutely. And so this is what we're going to do. We're going to continue to gain familiarity with truth in every which way we can possibly do it. I should have the video with the colorful artistic backgrounds that should be rendered. I've been working for 3-4 days on that. It just goes on and on and on. It's very difficult to get it all properly done. Very time consuming. But that's an aesthetic video. This is going to be more of a clear theoretical video. We'll see what we can do here. So hopefully everyone has survived the holidays, and we're ready to go full blast. And what is said now in full blast mode is a little bit different than what has been said before. Okay, because that now this is a higher sort of intensity and recognition, and it's time for that. It's the gist of what I did this morning was that I am not a savior. There is no savior. I don't want to be a savior. From what? Savior from what? From what? Everything is perfect. There's no need for any savior at all. We don't need to be saved from anything at all. I'm not a teacher. I'm not a guru. I'm not a savior. This was how I started it. And it really, really developed richly. And I was able to just examine the world and the madness that we're supposedly trapped in. We're not really trapped in it. And the last thing anybody would want to be would be a savior, actually. So this is a flipping the script on the whole savior script. Now, we got into a little conversation this morning about Jesus and Christmas and the birth of Jesus and all that. And I was able to explain pretty clearly what that really was about. And the funny thing is that Christians have the tools right in their hands, but they don't know how to use them. It's Jesus said, don't cast pearls before swine, but this is what has happened. Meaning, if you have a bunch of jewelry, beautiful pearls, and the farmyard, barnyard hog will, you know, take its snout and push the pearls around, but and we think, oh, it's enjoying the beauty of the pearls. No, it's looking for something to eat. And it says, ah, these are not edible, and goes on its way to the mud and rooting around some garbage. This is what Jesus is talking about. And the truth is that, again, Christianity has the tools in their hands, and they don't use them. They don't use them. They say, well, Jesus took all our sins and paid for a price for our sins and all this kind of stuff. Well, almost, but they misinterpret it. What Jesus did, Jesus is the true light. Now, there's only the true light, but there's true light pretending to be crippled, to not be the true light, to be non-functional, not be able to function in a different way, but still the true light. There's only one true light, is still perfectly pure, unaffected by anything. Imagine someone who walking down the road and they decide to play just for kicks. They decide to act like they got a, you know, crippled their back, their leg, their foot, and they're hobbling along. And they do that for a little while. Then they say, okay, I'm tired of this game. And then they go dancing down the street, you know, just twirling and dancing, and they're perfectly okay. This is like the situation we're in. Everything here is make-believe. Everything is nothing but pretense here. So Jesus came into the world. He said, look, I know it's pretense. I'm the true light, and let me tell you truly, this is all 100% pretense. And they said, no way. This suffering is not pretense, Jesus. This sickness, this suffering, these afflictions, and death surely is not pretense. What are you talking about? And Jesus said, no, it's all pretense, 100% without exception. And they said, well, you got to prove that to us. Jesus said, okay, if that's what you want. And they said, all right, we're going to falsely accuse you, because that's something that causes us great affliction. We're going to hand you over to be tortured. You know, that causes us great affliction. And then we're going to scourge you and lead you out to the cross and then crucify you, the most terrible, fearsome death, and hand you over to death in such a manner. And surely this will cause the true light to be afflicted and changed. And Jesus said, okay, you go ahead. Guess what? I'll see you soon. So, and then a little bit after, you know, I don't know how many hours it was, but there was Jesus after the put in the grave and all this, and walking around fresh as a daisy. And he said, look, it's all pretense, including death, including torture, crucifixion, all of this stuff, false accusation, hatred, spitting, mocking, jeering, everything that you think, oh, this surely the true light has been changed. It's 100% pretense. Here's the proof. None of you are human beings. You're all spirit. You're all the true light. You're simply pretending. So when the Christians, they say, well, Jesus took all our sins. Well, what is supposed to be meant is that He took all our pretense and said, okay, you want me to appear this way? You want me to appear this way? You want me to appear to be dead? Okay, fine, I'll appear this way. It's just an appearance, just make-believe, but I'll do that for you just to show you it's mere make-believe. It's total make-believe pretending. Now, I don't know if anybody has physically pretended, but you can. I mean, I can pretend to be, I can't talk. I can talk now. See, I was pretending I can't talk, but I can. There's no power in the pretense. There's no power in the pretense. There's no separate power in the pretense. This is what Jesus was telling us. They said, well, surely Satan has some power over you and the power of death. He says, there is no such power. There is no power, separate power in the pretense. There's no separate power in the pretense. It doesn't exist. It's all the power is with spirit, the one who's doing the pretending. The pretending never leaves the pretender. The pretending never leaves the pretender. And so he proved this. Now, if Christians would understand this, they would have a great advantage coming up in this world. And because Jesus has already proved to us, we accept his proof. The idea of a Christian is we accept the proof that Jesus gave us, which is death is mere pretense. Jesus said, if you believe in me, you shall have eternal life. You shall never die. You shall never taste death. You'll have eternal life. Because it's all pretense. So Christians really can have eternal life right now. Well, everyone already has it, but we can drop the pretense. We don't need to go through crucifixion. We don't need to go through affliction. Jesus proved to us that all of that is mere pretense. None of it is coming from some separate power at all. So we can drop it this instant without any process whatsoever. Just like I ended my pretense. Just like that, without any process. You see, time, did I have to wait? I said, wait a minute. I have to wait for something to happen before I end my pretense. No, I can end the pretense right now, this instant. So those who accept Jesus' proof can't say, hey, we're free, right? We don't have to wait on anything. And you see, when the inside hits you, you just be quiet. The inside just hit me. The intensity of what I was talking about just hit me. And this is what we're looking for. We're looking to get hit in this way. Take a hit of truth. Take a hit of truth. Smoke the pipe of truth. Take a hit of truth here. So the afflictions that are coming upon the world, the trouble, we don't have to go through those at all. We say we stand with Jesus. We have faith in Jesus, meaning we believe that he what he proved to us, no, without question, the plausible inference, the weight of evidence is with Jesus and not with the ego. Okay, so the ego, mere suffering, death, all this stuff is not sufficient evidence anymore for us at all. At all. It would have to be truly reason, true reason, not intellect. It would have to be something reason. And Jesus has come with a Course in Miracles showing reason, that we have access to reason, and showing us his reason. So it would have to contradict the reason also that Jesus gives in order to have any plausible inference at all. So the burden of proof is with the ego entirely now. We don't have to sit around assuming that some, there's something that we still have to prove. No, Jesus already proved it. And truth is true for all. So if it's true for Jesus, it's true for us. This is what Jesus has said. So we don't have to be like fish in a barrel, or, you know, or just vulnerable, leave ourselves vulnerable, wide open, vulnerable, as if there's something. Some iffiness, some plausibility to the ego. There's no plausibility to what the ego said, that this is not pretense, that some of this is, if not all of it, is coming from some separate power. Okay, that is the least likely possibility there is. It is like 99.9999% likely that this is all pretense. Okay, there's nothing contradicting this. If we take the testimony of Jesus, there's nothing at all contradicting that it's all pretense. And all there is, ego has, is just a whimsical absurdity. That absurdity is true. You know, but isn't that more likely to simply our own whimsicality, and nothing more than that? There's nothing more to it than that. So the virtually impossible burden of truth is upon the ego, and we don't have to help it out in any way whatsoever. We don't have to put ourselves in harm's way, or even imagine ourselves in harm's way. The burden of proof is with the ego at a fundamental, basic level. Okay. Not at the body level. We don't have to, appearance level. Not at all. That's already been dealt with by Jesus. So Christians, they know that there's some tools. They're just not sure how to use them. They're trying. And of course, anyone can. What a Christian means is someone who believes that Jesus did prove this is all a pretense. That's all. That's all you have to believe. Now, can a Buddhist be a Christian? Absolutely. Absolutely. Anyone from any religion can say, hey, you know, Jesus did prove that this is all pretense, including death. This is all simply pretense. Here's someone who just happened to prove it here. So we don't have to change our religion to believe in the proof that Jesus has given us. Not at all. He just said it's true for one. The wind is one. Truth is one. If this is true for me, it's true for everyone. So Jesus was not trying to establish a religion based on idolatry of him at all. What he was doing was saying, look, pass on this faith in the tools. Learn to use these tools that I have given you. Just learn to use the tools that I have given you, that I have proven this to you, beyond any reasonable doubt whatsoever, beyond any reasonable doubt whatsoever. So all the ego is left with is just this pack of absurdity, which it's, you know, marketing constantly as if there's some grandeur to it, some magnitude to this littleness. This absurdity is just this absurd littleness trying to masquerade as something grand and momentous. It's not. It's just a very tiny, tiny littleness, which is absurdity. So we don't have to believe that littleness is anything other than littleness. That's it. We don't have to side with it. Again, I can believe in all Buddhist teaching. It doesn't contradict what Jesus did at all. Or Hindu teaching or whatever. It doesn't contradict. No contradiction whatsoever. And I truly, I feel that way through and through. I don't feel any conflict in me. I can talk Vedanta, non-dual, radical Dzogchen, whatever you want. It doesn't in any way interfere with the evidence that Jesus gave us. This is all mere pretense. In fact, that just reinforces the truth of all the great wisdom teachings. There's nothing that needs to be overcome. There's no power that needs to be overcome at all. We are the power that is doing, that is responsible for the pretense. We are that power. That's all he was telling us. He says, look, I'm the power of the pretense. I'll pretend to die, then I'll pretend to have to reappear as a body. He said, I have the power of pretense. I'm doing it consciously. I'm not denying it. So, those who said that Jesus has just one nature, monophysite, which is divine, were correct. And the human thing is a mere pretense. It's mere appearance. Was it diaphysitism of the two natures with a almost a homostatic union or something like that? A hypostatic union. This is not true. This is the Causadian creed that is said, at least in Catholic Mass. And some of it's right. God from God, light from light, true God from true God, light from light. Various things they say in there. Consubstantial with the Father. Begotten, not made. There's some truth in that. But when they talk about the dual nature, divine and human, that is absolutely not true. There's no such thing as human nature, human beings. It's all pretense. It's all pretense. God did not create this world and then create human beings and put human beings in this world. That is nonsense. It's all pretense. It's light pretending to not be light. Electromagnetic realm is light pretending to not be light. It's still light. The light knows that it's still light. God is the light, and light knows it's still light. Just pretending. We're just pretending. There's no separate power that's doing the pretending. So the problem that we have is we think there's some separate pretender that's doing the power, pretending, some power of darkness, and we need to defeat this power. And the light needs to go defeat this power. This is the delusion that grips us. We're in the grips of this delusion that something has to be done that is causing our affliction, causing our body, causing the world, causing it. No, nothing is causing it outside of ourselves, our own pretense. So it takes no time at all, no effort at all, really, to stop the pretense. The power of pretending is also the power to stop pretending. Nothing has changed with the power of the light. So a Christian can say to the ego, look, you take it up with Jesus. Jesus is the one that defeated you in terms of the lie, that exposed the lie of a separate power. So if you got a problem with me, you take it up with Jesus and the Holy Spirit. Don't bother me with your talk. If you convince them otherwise, then they'll let me know. Okay, so that's how it should go, right? Don't take it all on our shoulders. I found it's too difficult, really. I wouldn't say it's impossible. I would say it's quite difficult. It's easier. Just say, well, the Holy Spirit and Jesus believe that it's all pretense. So if you can change their mind and prove to them that they're the ones that are wrong, then go do it. Don't bother me. And then when you prove that, then I will see the change in their attitude and whatever they have, you know. And then I will say, okay, ego, you must be right then. But don't bother me with your stupid absurdity. You don't need to prove to me anything. I'm not listening to you. And this is a shortcut, is it not? That's why all you have to do is have faith. They say, have faith in Jesus and you're saved. Well, this is true. But it's never been, to my knowledge, correctly explained until now. They have the tools, they're not sure how to use them. They hold up the tools and expect everybody to applaud, but you know they're not using them properly. It's like we have the saw and the hammer and the nail gun and everything, but where's the house? You know, they're not building any house. They're just cutting down logs and sending nails into logs, but not really. The house isn't there. They don't have that. They keep thinking that this is real. The human, God created humans, that God created the world, that God created electromagnetism. They keep believing that false assumption. So then they keep saying, well, you know, it gets all tangled. So a Christian can accept the vision of oneness right now and say, well, if you want to change it, change it through Jesus, then go ahead, ego. But I'm not going to entertain you at all. So this is why we're practicing wow. Someone who accepts the help that Jesus has given, that doesn't interfere with the help that Buddha has given or anyone else has given, the rishis or you know, whoever you want to say, doesn't interfere with that at all. It provides a shortcut for sure. The ego might say, well, I don't know where Jesus is, I can't find him. I say, well, you're lazy, it's your problem, not mine. If you want to prove this wrong, then that's what you have to do, because Jesus already proved you're mistaken, ego. You're the liar. You're not an independent power. So if you want to assert that you're an independent power, that's got to be defeated, go talk to Jesus. Jesus just didn't defeat anything. He just exposed the truth, brought the truth to light. There's no independent power to defeat. So if the ego wants to claim it's independent power, it's got to go defeat Jesus with that. I mean, flip the script on Jesus directly, not with me, not with you. If you want to accept Jesus, then it's not our problem. In other words, Jesus is our champion. If the champion's defeated, then we must submit to the ownership of the ego. Now this harkens back to the old days where champions would fight one another of tribes. The tribes were not stupid. They said, hey, we don't want to wipe each other out completely, but we feel we have a right to this land. You feel we have, and let the champions decide. So they'd choose the strongest. Sometimes it's 3-on-3, sometimes 1-on-1. David and Goliath is an example. And the champions would do battle, and the victor then would take possession of the new lands. And you'd have to submit and be enslaved or work for that champion. And that was that. So Jesus was a champion of truth, come into the world, said, okay, ego, you're the tribe of egoic delusion. I'm going to show that you are not a separate power. You have no power at all, actually. You're a phantom power. No power. And so the ego was shown to have no power at all. So if the ego wants to claim power, it's got to go through Jesus. At least we can insist upon that. So I really haven't seen that before right now. I haven't really seen it clearly like this. Now, of course, the ego doesn't want that. It says, crazy Christian. The ego hates Christians, actually. Right? Because the ego wants to deal with us because we're weak. The predators like to prey on weak prey, where we're hobbled, we're limping around. And it doesn't want us to say, hey, ego, go deal with my champion there. If you want to take me down, got to take him, that champion, down first. The ego doesn't want that. Out in the wild, you know, the predators, like a pack of wolves or whatever predators, they follow a herd and they look for the crippled and lame in the herd. And then they focus in on that one. Imagine if the cripple and lame could say to the pack of wolves or pack of predators, hyenas or what, jackals, whatever, tigers, lions, hey, if you want to eat me, you've got to defeat my champion. And imagine if the champion of the herd showed up in front of that cripple and says, hey, you want to take on that one, first you have to take me on and vanquish me, and I'm not crippled or lame in the slightest bit. Of course, the ego would back off and say, wow, that's not fair. It's not fair. Of course, predator says that's not fair. Of course, the ego's going to say it's not fair. It wants our confusion. It wants to feed on our confusion. It wants to attack our confusion. Now, my mistake was I said, well, nobody's getting what Jesus said properly. And so I couldn't figure out what exactly is it. So I said, well, maybe I have to do it then myself and reach the same realization, but I don't really have to. Don't really have to do it. We can if we want. It's just kind of like in science, somebody proves something. Without any doubt, all the proof is there, and they repeat the experiment or whatever. You can show it. It's very convincing. Do we all just deny it? That's not a perfect example because their colleagues follow up on it. But Einstein lays out the theory of relativity. Everybody, you know, looks at it and they realize, hey, this is probably correct. You know, this is a, so it's why do we have to do the exact same experiment, everyone over and over and over again? Why? That's what the ego wants, right? It's delay. Why can't we say, you know, this ego, this whole thing has already been resolved. Jesus already resolved all this with you. So why are you bugging me with it? I'm no different than Jesus. The ego lies to us and tells us that we're different. Jesus insists that we're the same. Just one mind, one truth, one light for all. Therefore, if anything is true for Jesus, it's true for all of us. So we're not separate. We're not different. We're not under the power of some separate power pretense. Those who believe that Jesus is divine, we're human, have got it all wrong. That's not what he, or that, and that there's some hypostatic union of mystery and faith that makes a dual nature. This is not true at all. The ego wants to believe that we're different than Jesus. So this independent power pretense applies to us, but just not to Jesus. This is what it tries to say. And it doesn't like anybody having faith that what Jesus did was true, nor does it like anyone else coming along and also corroborating that either. It doesn't like either one of those. It says, it makes it too difficult to keep pretending. Come on. Wow, what a cold morning. White Christmas for sure. Frost everywhere. Everything was covered in white this morning. Got up real early. I woke up at 4 a.m. and did a lot of contemplation and going out. There's a full moon in the eastern sky, western sky. Full moon in the western sky. Quite startling. And white everywhere. The ground, the trees, the cars, the lawns, the roofs, the fences. Heavy, heavy, heavy frost. Beautiful. But cold. Still very cold. It's dry air now. Dry cold air is here. It's a little wind, biting wind. I think the East Coast has it good, much better than we do now. It's funny. What a juxtaposition. The ego wants to forget all about Jesus. He said, Jesus was just some rabbi who did good works, and that's what you should do now. Which is why I really excoriate the Pope Emeritus Francis. I excommunicated him with apostolic authority because he is emphasizing what the ego wants to be emphasized. What just works. The ego loves good works. Just doesn't want you to have faith that Jesus brought to light that all this is mere pretense. All sickness, all dyingness, all deathness, all sufferingness. It's all 100% pretense, and Jesus proved it. This is what the focus needs to be in Christianity. Yeah, but they keep applying Old Testament egoic equations to it. They just can't seem to get over the hump. They just can't seem to do it. But I certainly have. And it's not been easy because of this collective, in this world, this collective old mentality. And so you're a sinner. Jesus died for your sin, suffered all the sins for you, so that the wrath of God could be poured out on Jesus, and Jesus would die in your place. What is that? That's old mentality. It's egoic mentality. There's none of that. None of that happened. Jesus merely appeared to die. Now, some of the early Christians realized this and taught this, and they eventually, because of a political settlement with Constantine in the Roman Empire, to get peace in the empire, get everybody to agree to it, to a common creed, and everybody else was excommunicated. Those who believed that Jesus, it was mere appearance, were excommunicated. And it wasn't just Nestor, it was many others was it Docetism or something? I'm not sure what it was, but there were some who said no, it was Jesus, was this human form, was mere appearance. They had it right. At least as far as that goes. Mere appearance. But what they didn't add on is we too are mere appearance. Mere pretense. Just like we can turn ourselves into a cripple or afflicted with something, and people look at us, and if you act it out well enough, they think you're afflicted. They look at you and say, oh, this person's very afflicted. And you can just stop instantly and say, no, I was never afflicted. And they'd be shocked, like, wow, what's that? Well, it's pretense. The mind is able to project pretense to seem extremely realistic. But Jesus said, no, even though it appears to your senses and to your pretend mind, also it projects a pretend mind. This is very important to bring this to light. The mind that we think we're thinking with is a pretend mind. It's also pretense. We're used to thinking that we can pretend, like, but we can also pretend that we have a pretend mind, can't we? Can't we play dumb? Sure we can. Sure we can. We can play dumb. We're pretending we have a dumb mind. So what we've done is we've pretended we have this dumb mind that doesn't recognize pretense, because it itself is pretense. And we'd say, well, mind, if you recognize pretense, you'll cease to exist too. So we're afraid we'll lose our identity, our beingness, our intelligence, whatever. We'll lose our mind. But no, we'll just recognize this pretense mind was never mind in the first place. it's light pretending to be something other than what it is, giving appearance of a pretend mind. So the mental struggles we have is because we're using a pretend mind, a pretense mind, not our true mind at all. When we what the Holy Spirit does, it brings to light our true mind through reason. It logically infers it. Plausibly infers our true mind through reason. And when you use reason, not intellectual logic, but reason, is you begin to think with your true mind. You begin to reason with your true mind. You begin to see with your true mind. You begin to be aware with your true mind. You say, hey, this other mind, what is this? That's a pretend mind. And this pretend mind, I'm putting words in its mouth to make it seem like it's a mind. It's not a mind at all. It's a pretend mind and pretend appearances. So Jesus came into the world. He had his true mind, not his pretend mind. But he had an appearance of a body, a pretend body. Okay, but he didn't have a pretend mind so much, right? If at all. So So he was aware of that the body is mere. I'm projecting this mere appearance for the sake of helping, you know, give this teaching lesson. But I know it's all appearance. I know it's all pretend. That's why I said, you destroy his body, I'll raise it up in 3 days. It's not a problem. He could disappear. He could be in a crowd. Nobody could find him because he just stopped his appearance for a little while. And then he'd reappear. He'd appear to somebody, you know, and on a road here, and then he'd appear to someone else. He'd just appear anywhere he wanted to. So his mind was not a pretend mind. This is why he spoke a little differently than we're used to. Some of these great teachers, they speak differently. If I get into this deep contemplation, I'm able to say, have responses in that which are very different than what you'd expect the responses to be. And then when I get up in the morning and I go back into the routine of dealing with pretend people, pretend minds, you know, I don't want to scare the horses, so to speak, so I don't speak from my true mind so much. But it's there. I'm aware of it. It gets clouded over purposefully. I say, I don't want to startle people too much. But it's time to start speaking that way as much. I try to in these videos, but I can do way better than this. This is just a very, very filtered in terms of what's said, just because of the feeling like, wow, I don't want to come on too strong. People say, oh, yo, what is this? Don't frighten me. That just sounds like you're out of your mind. Of course, I'm out of the pretend mind. I'm not using the pretend mind. And they'll say, well, you go crazy. No, the pretend mind is just not being used. They keep thinking that it's the pretend mind has gone crazy when you're using the true mind. Not at all. It's just the pretend mind is not being utilized. You're not pretending. A stupid mind that's incapable of recognizing pretense. How I wish it was a little warmer. I have very good reason to want to go somewhere warmer because I tape outside. So I am calling, asking God for help for this. Send me on another vacation to where it's warmer. And I can keep, you know, do more taping. Plausible inference of that reality is still completely real, and all this evidence to the contrary is pretend evidence. Pretend. Jesus calls it like manufactured evidence. It's pretend evidence. We can't really manufacture any evidence, really. We can only pretend. It's pretense evidence. If we give evidence we're sick, well, I'm so sick. That's pretend evidence. We're pretending. All affliction, all vulnerability, all suffering is pretend. There's no exception to this. This is what Jesus showed us. That's why Christians say, well, all affliction was poured out upon Jesus. All the wrath of electromagnetism, egoic magnetism, all the pretense suffering was piled upon Jesus. And he resurrected from that. I said, look, didn't touch me at all. It was just I knew it was all pretense. Did Jesus suffer? No. That's another question. Did Jesus really suffer on the cross? He pretended to suffer. He was certainly aware it was pretense. He was absolutely aware it was pretense. Otherwise, he would have been in his pretend mind. And Jesus was not in his pretend mind. He was in his true mind, the one true mind. By what he said, it was obvious that he was in the one true mind. So he was completely aware, this is pretend suffering, this is pretend that has no power at all. Pretense has no separate power. So this is becoming more and more and more clear, and it needs to be. This is what I've been aware of my whole life, but just the collective delusion of this world is so much. Everyone's so much in their pretend mind. People keep interpreting Christianity through their pretend mind, and then insist that the conclusions satisfy the pretend mind, as if the pretend mind is real mind, and if they didn't have a pretend mind, they wouldn't have any mind at all. This is the trouble here. This is the trouble. And this is the continuity where you say, no, I'm not ready to leave my pretend mind. I'm afraid I won't have any mind at all. I won't know how to function. And this is why those who show the way can help out, is, you know, ease this concern more and more and more and more and more. And again, whatever is true for one of us is true for all of us. Jesus showed that what's true for us, him, is true for all of us. There's no separate truths at all. There's no special truths at all. When he says there's no special, that means there's no special truths at all. There's no special suffering at all. There's no special feeling at all, pretense feeling. All pretense is equally pretense. There's no one say, well, I have a special pretense that makes it real. That doesn't exist. That's not true. This is a real illness I have. No, it's a special illness. I'm all alone with this illness. It's a special. No, there's no illness that's true. There's no suffering that's true at all. So I'm not struggling with the information I saw this morning. If it's a struggle, I stop, I drop it. It means the wow is still strong. Now, the important thing is to say, oh, I feel comfortable getting to this information and seeing it, and I do. So don't struggle, because that makes us feel uncomfortable. And if we just allow ourselves to feel comfortable, we'll want to go back there again. Say, hey, that wasn't bad, I feel comfortable there. So by all means, do not struggle. Now, people that have faith in Jesus, they say, well, we know, you, ego, that you can't harm Jesus in any way, therefore you can't harm us in any way. We don't need to prove it again to you. What is proven for one is proven for all eternity. And again, the ego says, no, you got to prove it again. No, if it's proven once, it's proven forever, in truth. And I've been able to corroborate it through reason to a very strong extent. So that adds weight to it, you might say. It's not necessary, but certainly it adds weight. Like scientists corroborating someone's findings, that this is, you know, irrefutable, the evidence is right in front of our face. Copper wire, motor turns. I mean, they said, look, see, it's turning. It's right there. There's the evidence. So some people say, well, how does that work? And you can reason it out and explain it. But it's still, the evidence is still there. Now we get tricked by the ego saying, well, you have a very important role you can do. You need to do the same thing Jesus did. It's very important that you prove it also. This is a trick. This is a trick. Because then we don't accept the shortcut. It's a delaying tactic. Because the ego is then believing in time and space and specialness and saying, well, that you're all separate and you'll have separate minds. So Jesus' mind was just an anomaly. His mind was able to do that, but yours isn't. This is believing in separate minds. They're the pretense minds, pretend minds. We don't have to prove anything to the pretend mind. There's no mind there at all, actually. So what are we doing trying to prove anything to the pretend? The ego is just the pretend mind. The ego is just the defenses to try and keep us believing in the pretend mind, really. It's just the marketer and the advocate that the pretend mind is really a mind, but it's not. The ego is marketing nothing at all. So why do we need to prove anything to nothing? Again, it's absurdity, very little, extreme littleness, right? We don't need to entertain littleness. We don't need to try to make it great. Disguise its littleness. We don't need to try to disguise littleness for what it is. Absurdity is just this extreme littleness with no magnitude to it. This is more like a traditional California winter. It's cold. December is cold right now. It's going to be cold for the, I don't know, next 10 days. I mean, it's down to the low 30s, freezing, frost, and chilly. People have commented to me that they've been in like places where it's 10 degrees below zero, but they're out there in shorts and t-shirt. And it's not that cold. They're playing basketball, and they say, I don't really feel the cold. But they hear, you feel the cold. It's chilly, the chill. I think the marine layer. I dissipated another steed. It tried to hit me there. Just the dampness of the of everything, the moisture, the evaporation of it, the mere marine layer, the wind, etc. So when we see a winter day and the sun's out, it doesn't mean it's warm. You go inside in it and it's like you gotta thaw out. It takes a while just to thaw out. But it is a beautiful day. Absolutely sparklingly clear. And again, a little bit of chit-chat, let the wow, let it settle in so it's not overly intense. Get comfortable with it. Settle into a comfort zone. Now, of course, Jesus tells us that it's all this is pretense, so we are as good as Jesus. This is what he's saying, we're all the same. That all the power of pretense is within us, that's all. Jesus says we're free to pretend, as long as, you know, just realize that we're the one doing the pretending. There's not some separate force doing the pretending, imposing this upon us. Nothing's being imposed upon us, that's all. So we're exactly the same as Jesus. Nothing's being imposed upon Jesus. Nothing is being imposed upon Jesus. Nothing is being imposed upon us. We're the same. We don't need to do anything to be the same. We're already the same. We never did anything to be the same. We were created the same. All spirit is created the same. Same truth for all. Same freedom for all. Same oneness for all. Created this way. created, not made, consubstantial with the Father, the same, consubstantial, concurrent, consubstantial, all that. Maybe not concurrent. I mean, if you first came God, the prime creator, but intrinsically, there's an expansion too. So you might even say it's concurrent, consubstantial with the Father. It's absolutely true. We're the host. We're host to God. Not humans. Spirit. Spirit is host to God. And we're pretending we're humans. Well, how do humans host God? How does pretending we're not host to God, how does that host God? Well, obviously, that doesn't host God. Nothing cannot host God. Pretense cannot host God. God's already being hosted by Spirit. It's already the case. God is already being hosted by Spirit. Completely. We can't get rid of it. I need it to be about 84 degrees. So I can tape in shorts and t-shirt. I've been very tired these days. Exceedingly tired. I made some videos. I haven't posted them because I got so tired. I just couldn't stay awake. There's great strain and stress right now. I believe a lot of you are feeling this. Wouldn't be surprising at all. Boy, it's awful. In the evening time, I just feel just dead, you know, almost dead. It's just a deadness, very bad deadness. Thank God that the days are getting longer already. They are. It's amazing, you hit the 21st and then the 22nd, suddenly it seems like, oh, the days are much longer. How did that work? It seems to be fast change. I don't know how that works. But yeah, I went out yesterday, 5:45, there was still a glow in the sky. A little bit. Whereas before, it got dark at 5. I mean, so the days are getting longer as far as the light goes, which is awesome, which means we're headed towards warmer weather, which is awesome, except for the ski resorts, but let it snow in the mountains, that's fine. Longer days, beautiful. Now, from what we're hearing here, it is not at all a surprise if we succeed in preparing by the time we hit June and put the icing on the cake in June, so we're all done before July hits. That would not be surprising in the slightest bit. With the kind of progress we're making right now, we're really baking the cake. I mean, the oven's on. We just turned the oven up hotter. We baked it, and then we turned the heat up to put a nice glaze on the cake, finish it off. So we're turning the oven up here. I'm thinking about how do I get down to the warm lands again and take another vacation. I don't know. I don't seem to have a way. I'm thinking, how is it possible? This way, everything seems to be blocked. But I just have to let it go and let's see what the Holy Spirit can do. Again, I've said, put yourself in the place that infers, that reality is still real as much as possible. Plausible inference. Stay away from anything that doesn't give plausible inference. That includes any mental imagery, any mental thinking, internally imagination, external news, you name it, movies, entertainment, the world, issues, chit-chat, gossip, whatever it is. Stay away from that. And just, for me, to immerse myself in a golf course, nobody else is out there. It's just, I can just take these moments and just, wow. Maybe everything is perfect with reality. Maybe the light is perfect. I'm getting, you know, faint echoes of plausible inference here. So, Holy Spirit can work miracles. We know that. And, you know, I'm praying for a miracle that I go down there as much as possible, down to the desert, Coachella Valley, go down there as much as possible. And it lightens me up. It lightens me up. It gives me this boost. I feel like, yeah, we can do this. We need a boost. The more people can help with boost, the better in this world. Because I do feel there's this terrible sickness coming, deadness coming upon us. Really, this immobilization, this dictatorial immobilization is very much, very close. It could come through a false flag event. I don't know what's going to happen in July. Is some false flag event possible to impose some dictatorial global dictatorship on the world? I don't know. But something is coming, so I feel it's very important. That everyone who's capable, willing to receive as much a boost as possible, not right now, should receive it. Should receive it. I say this to everyone. I want everyone to be in the place that makes them, gives them plausible inference that reality is still real. And all this is, world is mere pretense. The body, all suffering is mere pretense. I want everyone to experience that right now. Not just me. Everyone. This is my prayer. May everyone find the means to be in the place that for them gives the strongest possible plausible inference that the pure light is still 100% pure. It's always been 100% pure. Reality is still 100% real. Nothing has changed. Nothing's been corrupted in any way whatsoever. And that all evidence to the contrary is mere pretense. I want everyone, may everyone find themselves, find the means to put themselves in that situation right now, everybody. Even if it means everyone stops work, you know, it doesn't matter right now. I feel the importance is so strong. May everyone find the means to stop work too, absolutely. Unless work gives them the highest plausible inference that reality is still real. And we spend the next 5 months in this wonderful plausible inference, giving ourselves maximum boost because there's something coming in the world that is designed to impress the pretend mind and make the pretend mind feel important, that it's somehow right, of that reality has changed. Something is coming that seems to immobilize us. I feel this is this deadly fatigue I'm experiencing. So I hold out hope. I don't see how it's possible, but faith, you know, the faith tells us to reach beyond what we're seeing with our mere senses, with pretend mind. Pretend mind doesn't see how it's possible. Pretend mind says, no, I have insufficiency to do this. Well, that insufficiency may just be supporting the pretend mind. Supporting the belief in the pretend mind. Supporting the belief in pretense. This is what the insufficiency may be there for. At this point. So we don't need a surplus. We just need sufficiency. Now I could have a very small, meager retirement that I could take out that would last a couple weeks or something, or maybe a month. I don't know what I could do with it. But people would get super angry with me if I did that. They would say, "You're crazy. You can't do that." So, you know, it's like you don't want to do something that other people insist that you're crazy. I had some land I wanted to sell, but the others also have co-ownership of it. They have some say, and they blocked it. They said, no. That's for later. Well, later's too late. Later is too late. There's something coming in this world that where it's going to try to strengthen the belief in the authority of the pretend mind to such an extent that we could fall under its spell again. So later is too late, in my opinion, in this world. All trends are in that direction. What I have heard during this Christmas season and going into this is simply that the ego's putting the hammer down on everyone's pretend mind. The pretend ego's putting the hammer, pretend hammer on the pretend mind. But our continuity fear has us wavering. One step at a time here. We're working fast, so we have to bake that cake real fast. Not everybody would go to the same place. People have different areas that they find helps them with plausible inference that reality is still real. It's not necessarily going to be the same place for everybody. It doesn't have to be. Based on our each of our pretenses is somewhat unique. So it seems like there's all this separation, separate minds. If we're all pretending the same way, it'd be easy to infer that they're not separate minds. So we're pretending in all different ways. So therefore, plausible inference has to work with our continuity issue. So it would be different for different people. It's important. Wow, this for me, this where I am in now, Silicon Valley, it's hell. It's absolute hell. I mean, I don't feel any plausible inference that reality is real at all. I have to work at it totally in my mind every day. And sometimes we get used to place and the suffering that all the pretense we've gone through. It's good to get away from a place where you have all the memory of pretense, a long history of pretense. It's not a good place to break through. Sometimes you need to go to start fresh somewhere else that helps you drop the pretense and you feel more energized. Say, wow, I was just pretending in that place to get along with people. There's a massive amount of pretense I have to engage in here just to get along. Massive. It's got to be the most deluded place in the world, I think. There's nothing dumber than people who think they're smart. They think that the pretend mind is smart. That's the dumbest thing of all, right? Is identification with the pretend mind. So yeah, I got a really smart pretend mind, and I'm making it smarter all the time. I'm learning how to be smarter all the time. This is the height of stupidity, or the depths of stupidity. And of course, they don't see. They think that the pretend mind is the true mind, and it can get smarter and smarter and smarter and develop, because they say, well, it's not that smart now, but we can keep working and we'll pass on our knowledge into succeeding generations, and ultimately we'll build up this incredible mind, pretend mind. This is, again, the depths of delusion, depths of ignorance. So it's an extremely ignorant place, that's the Bay Area of California. Extraordinarily ignorant place. Very arrogant in the smartness of the pretend mind, without any awareness that it's actually just a pretense. This is extraordinary ignorant place. Very barbaric place here, actually. I call it sophisticated savages here. I live among sophisticated savages, which is the worst kind of savagery there is. Those who say, well, my pretend mind is dumb, I got a real dumb mind, well, it's not quite as severe as those who say, I've got a real smart, sophisticated, ever-growing, more intelligent pretend mind that's going to become the real mind, or something that is the real mind. That's sophisticated savagery. That's the worst. Well, we'll see what the Holy Spirit will do. I mean, what can I do but put it in His hands and have hope? And I don't feel I can do much of anything. I'm so caught up in having to pretend that I'm dumb because I believe in the true mind. They think I'm dumb, so I need to pretend like even my pretend mind is it's dumb or stupid, which is pretense too. It's nothing actually, but I'm not allowed to bring through my true mind here, because that would show that everyone else here that the pretend mind is a pretend mind, which they don't want to believe. They feel very, very outraged by that. Like I'm showing them up. How dare you have a college education? How dare you show up a college educated pretend mind? It's outrageous. The good thing on a golf course is everybody's sort of struggling and kind of dumb, and there's something about it where you're not really into your pretend mind so much. I hit a shot with my pretend mind, and then I say, okay, let me hit a shot with where I don't really believe in my pretend mind, and then let me hit a shot that I fully realize it's completely pretense. And different shots, one, idiot shot, great idiot shot, great amateur shot, and then great pro shot. It just depends on what my belief. I believe that the pretend mind is not a mind at all, then I hit a great shot, pro shot. If I believe the pretend mind has some causative power, I hit a idiotic shot, great idiotic shot. If I believe, have faith in the one true mind, and that this is pretend mind, if I have faith in that, I hit a great amateur shot. If I really know, experienced, there's no doubt, then I hit a great pro shot. So may we all have our golfing vacations for the next 5 months. Let everyone just go play golf for the next 5 months, actually. That would be very helpful for the world. For all of us, actually. Very helpful. Of course, the coming dictatorship doesn't want that. It wants us to be all very, very focused on the pretend mind, thinking. And we think the dictators are actually the part of the causative agency of the pretend mind, that we're not aware of. We're not sure what's causing this, but we think the dictators, they're part of the causation of this pretend mind. So we need to pay very close attention to what they have to say. It's very important, because that's the only way we feel we can educate and help this pretend mind grow and become more vibrant, and so we're content with it. We're not content with it the way it is, of course, because it's not real. It's not a real mind. It's not a mind at all. It's mind pretending that there's some other mind. other than the one mind. So of course we're not content with that. How can we be content with that? It's impossible. So there's this growing intensity that we need to, there's someone we need to pay attention to. There's something that's coming in the world. That maybe the two witnesses, maybe the two dictators, you know, that we really need to pay attention to, because they somehow are in touch with the causative, whatever caused this, the causative power of this fake pretend mind. So that we think that they have the answer for us. And so we need to be really, really please them by our actions and our words and our thoughts, and be completely into our pretend mind, so that they say, well, okay, well, you're worthy for us to come here and clue you into the secrets that we know about and the truth. And I say, oh, thank you. But if you don't, you know, if you don't believe in the pretend mind, we're not going to show up. Yeah, you know, so people are in this mood that they, and of course the dictators say, well, you have to make sure everybody else pays attention to us also. Zeke Heil, you know, Zeke Heil, that everybody has to pay attention to these dictators. And so everyone's being a good Nazi right now in informing on anybody that's not. And they're saying, hey, you need to be serious. The answers are here. You know, the inner secrets are being given to us. Our relevancy is being explained to us. Our roles are being given to us. Wow. You know, and if you don't believe in the dear leaders, then you're undermining, you know, their willingness. This is how it's, the ego presents it to us. Maybe I just need to go just ride a Harley somewhere, you know, and some some completely away out of the way place. I've never ridden a motorcycle in my life. Maybe it's time just to get on a motorcycle out in the outback somewhere for 5 months. Just get away from the world entirely. Because the whole world is channeling their efforts now to pay attention to this coming dictatorship, this coming something that's supposed to reveal to us the reality of this pretend mind. Of course, they're only pretend dictators too. They're just a pretense too. How can pretense reveal to pretense the reality of pretense in terms of having its own separate causation from reality? How is that possible? Surely, this is a little tiny absurdity. That's all it is. I wonder, maybe I'll ride a BMW. Whoever has spare parts, you know, now everything will work great. Yeah, that would be fun. I could learn to ride a bike. I'm trying to get fitter. I wouldn't ride a bike in Silicon Valley. It's a death sentence. We just keep doing the best we can here, and you know what? However it comes, I'll just keep working at it. What can I say? I get miffed by the seemingly non-responsiveness of help, but sometimes I say I'll just stop. I said no, but that's not true. I will continue to give the best effort I can, whether the Holy Spirit seems to help me or Jesus helps, whatever. I'll keep giving a full effort here. I'm not, you know, I'm not going to stop believing in truth just because there's an apparent lack of support for it. what's vitally important is to get comfortable with the truth. Try to use aesthetics. Try to use everything that at our disposal. Use everything at our disposal. The days are getting longer. That's good. Maybe day trips. Maybe I'll have to try to start doing that. So you don't have the hotel costs. Just gasoline costs as possible. I have to start looking into whatever's available. I can't just sit around waiting for this to happen. I don't want to just wait. I need to just try to do whatever we can do. So let's just pray for that. Problem with following sports teams is, what if your team starts losing? Like following the Golden State Warriors right now, you feel like a plausible inference that reality is real if you're a Golden State Warrior fan, which I've been since the mid-60s, something like that. Of course, they've given us plausible inference that reality is not true for most of those years. Terrible. But now they're giving the plausible inference like, hey, wow, they can't lose. Every time they play, you know, it's impossible that they can lose. They just can't lose. Except for, you know, occasional aberration, too tired and injuries and stuff. But other than that, they're going to win. So it's a feeling, it does a feeling like an invincibility. But that can turn, you know, an injury, boom, like that. Just like following the Giants, they win the World Series, and next year they don't even make the playoffs. And you're like, oh God, it's terrible. And then the next year they win the World Series. Oh, this is great. Next year they don't make the playoffs. Next year they win the World Series. Next year they don't make the playoffs. It's like roller coaster. So this is the trouble with identifying with people, with teams, with stuff like that. You can't count on it. 49ers, they were great, 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 and then they, for a long time, best team in football, then they went through terrible times, and then they almost became the best team in football, but couldn't quite win the Super Bowl. And now they're just like the worst team in football, just hideous, hideous, hideous. Nobody goes to the games, the stadium's empty. It's extraordinary. Everybody's completely, the 49er fans are just like, they're like in shock. They're so angry. They're so upset because they depend on the 49ers to give them plausible inference that reality's real. And it's just the opposite now. So that's a very dangerous thing to put our hopes in, that sort of inference. Beautiful places are a little different. Like the weather is just always so beautiful, and the place is so spacious and quiet and peaceful. Then we can, you know, draw a little better inference. California has helped me out in that way, but I get very upset when everything's not perfect, because then my inference starts to collapse. So, the inference in places is again, not stable. We understand that. Golf courses help if they keep them immaculately in condition, but even that, you go out on a course now and it's muddy. The drought has hurt it in California. Various issues arise. It's not in immaculate condition. You kind of go, ah, that's terrible, terrible. You want to go out and just you can smell the new mown lawn. In the morning they mow the lawn, you can smell it, and it's like that the lawn is perfect and the trees are perfect and the green is rolled and it's just flawless and just everything. You say, oh, it's always this way. Reminds me of reality. It infers a plausible inference of reality that it, in reality the lawn is always freshly mown and it's just perfect. So that tends to have a strong, strong, you know, inference. If they can keep it up, but keep keep the maintenance going, but it doesn't always work that way. Actually, there's all sorts of storms, trees are come down, waves, flooding, droughts, freezing, all sorts of various issues that can arise. People, I like to watch golf on television, like the Augusta National, the Masters. Every year it presents a picture like this. It's always like this. It's always immaculate. It's always this. The flowers are always blooming there. And you just say, wow. Of course, it's not exactly that way. They present on TV as if it is. Eternal spring there. It's not. Although the flowers may be blooming early there this year because it's so warm. No, actually, in the south, it's not so warm. It's more like the east Midwest. Yeah, that's right. Actually, supposed to be cool for the south this El Nino year. So it's difficult to find anything in this world that doesn't let us down. So we have to understand that just the preponderance, we want to get as much weight as possible. Some people go see the great gurus, but the great gurus, some of them move around. They can't stay with them all the time. Stuff happens in life. You got to leave them. They get very powerful inference from them, for sure. Which is why the guru system is very powerful. It's the most powerful positive inference, plausible inference that reality is real, is these great teachers, the saints. Christian tradition, various traditions, they call them saints. You know, some are called sages, some call them gurus, some call them this or that. And they give this very powerful, plausible inference that the light is still 100% pure. Nothing has changed, nothing has happened, reality is still real, very powerful. And yet, you can't stay with them all the time. Stuff happens, you might stay a little while, then you have to leave and go take care of stuff. And some might stay a year or two, and some might travel a little bit with them. But the guru system, like in the East, had this, is you have as many of these enlightened beings, non-pretending beings as possible, appearing here in the world, and as many people as possible have access to them occasionally. It would be like going to like Pebble Beach, you go play golf at Pebble Beach. Well, they go take a journey trip and go see this great guru, and they spend maybe a week there, but it's such a profound week, it changes their life forever. They become very much faithful that reality is still real and nothing has changed that fact, and this is true for everyone. And it changes their outlook of their life, no question about it. Here, people, I want to go golf in the Del Monte Forest, but it's so expensive, who can afford that? I've never played Pebble Beach. And the other one, well, Spyglass, you can play. Someone treated me to Spyglass, and then there's the Monterey Country Club, but you have to know somebody there. You can't get on, but you can play Poppy right now, but it's very expensive, like $200 or something. Unless you have a Northern California Golf Association membership, or then it's less. But some people use that as try to remind them of plausible inference, the settings. You know, a lot of people like Pebble Beach, the settings are such as makes you feel like, wow, this is so beautiful. Maybe reality's still wonderful. Forget all your troubles. Forget, really, you play around a golf there and you just really forget about the world. You really do. It would knock you out. I mean, I've walked along the edge of the cliffs there. And you get the feeling, I've seen the clubhouse and all that, and watching on television, you get the feeling. Of course, it could also be windy and foggy and cold, and you think, wow, this is terrible. I give the wrong inference. I'd rather have it 85 and no wind and still and calm, yeah, rather than the blustery ocean. Blustery oceans can be very, very nasty. Cold there. So we're just brainstorming here. We need a full-on success now. Full-on success. I'm just trying to say, what is it? In our minds, we need to say, what is it that can really build my plausibility index? That reality is still real. And that there's no external cause for pretense at all. Which means this whole universe, electromagnetic universe. There's no external cause for this whatsoever, external to my mind. There's no external cause to my mind for bodies, for sicknesses, for circumstances, for situations, for death. No external cause whatsoever. It's all 100% pretense. This is what we have to get to. The more we can feel, have this inferred, the better it is for us. Now, like I said, the guru system is great, but we don't have that system right now. People had access to that. This is so helpful for a culture. It creates a spiritual culture. It's the only way, as far as I know, is people actually go to these teachers and get this plausible inference that there's no external causation to pretense, and it profoundly tips the balance in favor of truth. And we have many of these teachers are all over the country, and millions, the whole population of ultimately they go and they have contact with these teachers. This creates a spiritual culture. It's the only way I know to create such a culture, to bring it about. Now in the world, especially the Western, there's no such culture like that at all. So we have to go to resorts. We have to go. Oh, someone. I just talked to someone. This is very interesting. This is the second situation with Hawaii that has occurred back to back. Actually, I know someone who went over to Hawaii. That how was it? Terrible. Well, they say it was like super hot. Someone said it was like way too hot or rainy. Someone said it was, well, one was raining all the time. The other one said it was way too hot and muggy. The trade winds stopped and it was just super humid and hot. And he said, I came back home. It's just horrible over there. Couldn't stand it. And now I talked to someone just a couple days ago who planned to be over there the entire Christmas season through New Year's. And they come back a couple days before Christmas. They came back. Yeah, they came back. Wednesday, so it's 2 days before Christmas, they just got back. I said, what happened? And they said, how was it? And they said, horrible. It's a trip to hell, they told me. It was a trip to hell. And what happened is one of them gotten sick, very sick. They got misdiagnosed. They got sick. Someone on the airplane was coughing, was sick, and got severe bronchitis. They had to come back, get out of there, and to get back to doctors here. They said it was just hideous. We didn't have any of the doctors, people we knew, the home care, everything. They said we just jumped on a plane, got home as fast as possible. So this is really very interesting to me, that Hawaii is thought of as the place you go, you know, and everything's wonderful. But they said, well, there's a whole different, what was explained to them, there's a whole different host of viruses and bacteria and everything there because of the different climate, and we're not accustomed to it. So you come from somewhere else, it's easy to get sick there. Actually, people have been telling me also they've been getting colds over there and troubles. And I said, huh, what? So I said, I think I'll stick to California. They said that too. They said we're just going to stick to cars. This is what they told me. This is very interesting. These are very wealthy people, and very good people. And they said, we're just going to go on car vacations now. And I said, hey, you know, that's what I do. I don't take airplanes, just stay in cars. I'm going to stay in California. And they said, yeah, we are too. We're going to go to some place in California. And they mentioned some place that I might want to go to. I've never been there, where very wealthy people go. It's another really nice getaway. They said, that's what we're going to do. So maybe that's the Holy Spirit telling me, just stick with cars, car vacations in California, where you're used to the climate. We're not going to get sick, presumably. But no, I said, I have confidence I'm not going to get sick here. I'm not going to pretend to be sick. No time to pretend to be sick. Really, it isn't. So I actually have a couple places. Maybe I'm starting to start look into it and start doing this actually. Okay, so they're making headway here. So now the guru system's not in place. So what if there was a enlightened being here, a truly realized brother, sister, what we'll just say brother, generic term, truly realized brother in spirit, make themselves available to just, you just come and see me, that's all, just hang out. I mean, I don't understand why this isn't happening. Forget about retreats. We have to pay. Just, hey, I'm here. Everyone can just come here. We'll just hang out together. Because you get the inference just by hanging out, actually. Not by asking questions and trying to quiz their pretend mind about how real their pretend mind is, as everyone thinks that their pretend mind has become real somehow. No, they realize it's never been real. It's only pretend. It's not a mind at all. But you can get that just being in the presence of these beings. It's just being in their presence, actually, that's the real key. It could be free. It could just be free, actually. But I just don't see that being made available. It's pretty extraordinary. It's no time to get wealthy, you know? It's a time to go out to just prepare, make it available. So that's always been my hope. I could play some role in that. I don't know if that would happen or not. Right now, my presence isn't such that others would have strong plausible inference that this mind, human mind, this mind is nothing but complete pretense. It's not strong enough. But if it gets strong enough, maybe I'll do just that. Maybe I'll do that. I don't know. That's an option. Maybe that's not in the cards. I don't know. But we need to find out what's in the cards and start doing it. And keep in mind, here's something that's very important. I've realized there's a lot of realizations that have been taking place. Now, the progress has just been extraordinarily rapid. And one of those is that when you come to a sage, a guru, a saint, etc., the whole purpose is plausible inference. That's it. And so you have to come there with the faith that you're going into a powerful plausible inference situation and put that context, wrap it in that context. Otherwise, you're not going to get anything out of it. It's just a waste of your time, actually. That is the context. So whatever you say, it's you're giving the benefit of the doubt to that context. You have to, because everything here is just plausible inference in this realm of perception is plausible inference. So you're not going into some different context. You have to, and you could use it negatively, plausibly infer that they're not, not realized, and that you're not getting benefit, and you need to try to change their mind, change what they're about. And that gets nowhere. That's a waste of time. So you don't. You look for the signs. You look for it. You say, I'm here, I'm going to get it here and here and here and here and here. Don't try to interfere with it. It's not a contest. It's not one-upsmanship. It's not anything like that. It's like I say, you get out of what you put into it. So you get as much as possible. You soak it in. Just soak it in. Just soak in the overall plausible inference, which can be quite subtle. I mean, maybe we think it's subtle. Maybe it's obvious to others. But it can be in this way, and this way, and this way. The whole thing can be just this wonderful, wow. Whereas others can say, I'm going to go and ask them a question. I got to, you know, find out this and this question. This is the fool's way. Because words, answers to questions, usually do not give so much plausible inference. They can. Like I asked Longchenpa the first time I saw him in a dream. I didn't know who it was, but I felt the inference that he'd given me by walking across this ocean on this very narrow little footpath, so to speak, just beneath the surface, from far, far away, crossing this whole ocean. I said, this is someone extraordinary. Well, who is it? I don't know. So I said, was the ocean, was it warm or was it cold? And he said, it was both warm and cold. And so that gave me plausible inference that I'm dealing with a sage here. So it can give you that. The sage can respond, but the responses are going to be quite different than what the pretend mind thinks. They're not going to strengthen the pretend mind. So if you go there thinking the sage is going to strengthen your pretend mind, believe that that has some external causation to it, then it's a waste of time. Waste of time. It doesn't matter if you pay $1 million. It's still going to be a waste of time. So if you go there skeptical, try to strengthen your skepticism, that's not the way to go into it at all. Now, the kingdom of nowness is completely indifferent, ultimately, to any evidence that it's the kingdom of nowness. It's irrelevant, ultimately. Totally irrelevant. Evidence is irrelevant. Plausible inference is a little different than evidence, okay? This is important. We're not looking for empirical evidence. We're looking for plausible inference. So this is the key point with what has to do with teachers. I used to be very in tune with Sri Sri Anandamayi in the plausible inference. She gave extreme plausible inference that truth is true, and only truth is true. But it was all inference. I was willing to infer, work on the level of plausible inference instead of, you know, give me this empirical evidence, scientific evidence, or let me refute this and do the dialectic, logical thing and all this. I didn't use that at all. I just said, wow, I recognize it. I can recognize it. Now, feminism has sort of made that very difficult now because they insist that it's because she's a woman. She said, well, the reason why, you know, you're getting positivity is because she's a woman, and women have the plausible mind. The pretend mind of women is real. You know, it's just only men's mind, pretend mind, that's not real. So if you pay attention to women's pretend mind, then you'll learn how to have a true, make a pretend mind real. You know, this is what feminism is really about. The woman is always right, sort of thing. And so this has gotten in the way of that plausible inference with Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, unfortunately. But I still had a very long run there, a very powerful, so I know what it's like. That was, well, I may say radical feminism of today has gotten in the way. Feminism doesn't really get in the way, actually. It's the radical feminism, which is really a precursor to this dictatorship, global dictatorship, and whatever troubles are to come. It's telling us we need to focus our attention on that and make the pretend mind real. That's what radical feminism really about. It's asserting the right of mother is always right, playing that card, the mother is always right, meaning the electromagnetic pretend mother is always right. Where Sri Sri Ananda, my mom was not an electromagnetic pretend mother. She insisted she wasn't. Never even been in this realm at all, appeared here before, and insisted that their appearance, you should just look at it, just a little child, that's all. Not the mother at all. No mother card at all. Did not play that card. So, but what Radical Feminine has done is played the mother card, which is a very nasty card to play. It's the worst card here. But that's what Nazi Germany played, the mother card, the Fraulein card, absolutely. And said, you got to put your attention on the Führer. It was the women that conformed Nazi Germany. Radical feminists of Nazi Germany, that's the ones who really did it, put their attention. Otherwise, it wouldn't have happened. So we're having this Fraulein Nazi card played around the world right now. Nazi Fraulein card. And this is what's really gotten in the way. So I find I'm not able to use Sri Sri Anandamayama in the same way, because people don't have the same inference pattern anymore. They're not able to infer very well at all. They just think, oh yeah, see, mother's always right. She's always right. All women are always right. Even pretend mind women, they have an external cause. Your mother has an external cause that only mothers can know about, only women can know about. The men, they don't know about it, but we'll clue them in, and we'll train them and teach them. We got these great dictators coming that'll get us all our attention and explain our relevancy to us and tell us how to be truly human. This is the nonsense spiel, insane spiel. This is this raving of lunatics, actually. So this has gotten in the way, but I had this experience. I know what it's all about. So I can certainly have it again, even more powerfully. And certainly nothing had to be said. You don't need to listen. I never heard of any of her teaching, hardly at all. I mean, in her own voice, certainly not. I was in Bengali. I didn't have no idea what she was saying. It didn't matter. It made no difference whatsoever. I just said that this is the true light. There's no question about it. It's just the evidence was overwhelming. The inferences, plausible inferences, were overwhelming. I didn't need any teacher needed for her to say anything, really. Just the sound of her voice, the quality of her voice, like a child, but like a completely certain that there's only the true light. That's all. All light is the true light, and it's perfect. And just say, what are you talking about? Everything's perfect. It's the way she handled everything is completely obvious to me. The inference was extraordinary. Doesn't matter what the teaching was. Didn't matter what, the trappings were. Doesn't matter. Those are superfluous. You see right through that stuff. It's just superfluous. Let the superfluous stuff be superfluous. Let the little stuff be little. It's the inferences you get, the plausible inferences you get from these beings of the true light, who remind us that we're also beings of the true light. We're just pretending not to be. How are we doing here? Pretty good. It's getting a little warmer out here. A little warmer. I don't know. I think I'll survive. I have a sweater under this too. Got a new sweater. Who doesn't get a sweater for Christmas? So got that on. And merino wool. It's pretty warm. And then this, whatever this. What do you call this thing? Polar tech. That type of fabric jacket. But it's still, my feet are chilly because I got these tennis shoes on that are designed for to breathe. You got all these posers saying, look how great the fake mind, the pretend mind is making us. Look how fashionable we are. Look how we can pose like we're knowledgeable and we're authoritative. It's just overwhelming in the world, all this authoritative posing, all these posers. Mostly, the authority is with women now, there's no question about it. Extraordinarily so. And this is keeps being pointed out to me over and over and over and over and over. And it's with the woman as mother, actually, and the belief that mother has a external source, has a causation separate from the one mind that is responsible for the flesh and for the world and for nature and all this kind of nonsense, instead of the fact that it's completely coming from our own, the one mind, pretending. There's no external causation whatsoever. This is the key truth in this world culture right now, is absolutely denying this key truth and insisting on another truth. It's almost overwhelming. Remember, Jesus said, if it wasn't given unto you to harm this body, you couldn't harm a hair on its head. In other words, if Jesus didn't agree that he'll agree with the appearance of being harmed, then no appearance of being harmed could happen whatsoever. This is truth. So, I mean, the teachers in the world, they have to make the invitation. You know, it's up to them. It's up to them to say, hey, folks, I'm here for you. Everybody, anyone wants to come see me, just come see me right now. And what are the requirements? No requirements. You just sit quietly, is all. And Krishnamurti used to just sit quietly in Ojai and just give talks, and everybody sat quietly. This is very powerful. But there are a lot of people, the economy is brutal on people. The haves and the have-nots. There are so many... I don't know who is on in the area I live. Everybody's so wealthy, it's ridiculous. But I'm sure all over people are in very, very tight budgets. But you wouldn't know it, would you, through the Christmas season and the people going buy. It seems like Americans all have a ton of money. It's amazing. I don't. I absolutely don't. I'm on like the edge of a cliff. Edge of a financial cliff. And so teachers just say, hey, everyone, just come. Come freely. Don't have this two-tiered system of, well, if you have money, pay, and if you don't have money, you don't have to pay. No, just everybody come free. If you want to make a donation, I mean, maybe you don't even accept donations, forget it. If there's some sponsors who can sponsor it, that's a different story, but it really should be no donations. No charge, no donations, period. And if there's a few wealthy donors that can sponsor the whole thing, I think that's the best way to do it, actually. That's how I see it. I really don't like the whole thing about donations or charging. If I went to something one time, I had to prove my hardship. They had a whole bunch of people interrogating me, and even then they said, well, you got to pay something. We'll do a sliding scale. I didn't have anything. Sliding scale, you know, it was just, it made you feel like you're not welcome. It was a terrible experience. So forget it. Everybody free. No donations accepted. And if someone wants to step up as a sponsor, that's a different story entirely. They're not special. They don't have special access, really. I mean, obviously, if someone's going to sponsor, then they're pragmatically, there would be more access, and, you know, good for them. Good for them, if they want to do that. And that's how they want to get more plausible inference, and more power to them. Sure, that shouldn't be blocked. But I just hate this thing about, you know, these spiritual teachers, they say free, and then love offering, $10 love offering, $20 love offering. I mean, come on. It puts everybody under this feeling of, I don't know, I don't like it. Like you have to get something out of it through the pretend mind or something. It's free is free. Free is free. It's unqualified. And I know what it's like to not have money, and you don't want to, you just feel when you're dealing with subtle plausible inference, it's you don't want to try to attach a monetary value to it at all. How much do I donate? How much am I getting? It interferes. It interferes. It really interferes. It should be free. So there's no question of how much am I getting out of this. Keeping track, trying to think like in that whole way, it puts you in the wrong state of mind. Again, we shouldn't judge against those who have money either. If they want to have like some situation where it takes money, that could also be accommodated. We're not into class warfare here in any way. Everyone has different circumstances of pretense. So hopefully everything can be ironed out. If anything at all happens, I don't know. I'm looking for the teachers who are saying, everybody, I'm here, just come, and it's free. And make it crystal clear up front. There's absolutely no charge to come see me, and there never will be. And there's no donations accepted, and there never will be. We don't have time to fool around, really, right now. So, I keep looking. I keep searching the internet. Anyone saying, hey, I'm here now. I don't know. I haven't found him yet. But, again, we should expect them to keep working as what we do here. Just keep working at it. We're doing a great job here, actually. This is what I feel. Doing a great job. Free access here to the advice and sharing of encouragement. Of course, I'm being subsidized by family. Subsidized. And kept going. That's a different issue. Different issue. It's that, you know, it's not a spiritual subsidization. They don't even know what I'm doing. But I'm helpful, very helpful. So there's that situation. Plus I'm working. Very hard work. Very stressful, difficult work. To make it possible. If I wasn't working, then I'd have to be subsidized somehow. This is absolutely. But again, I don't know what the Holy Spirit will do. We just have to do the best we can do, each one of us, where we're at. And hopefully the momentum will build and build and build in the next 5 months. It's still sufficient time. I look at us, we have sufficient time. Because we're making huge breakthroughs every day. Too cold today to do anything, really. I'd like to do something.